Exploring new flavours with new friends. John Torode's Australia. Brought to you by Emirates.
I'm John Torode. And 20 years ago, as a young chef, I packed my bags, I left Australia and pursued a career in London. Now I've flown home to where it all began for me. Growing up in Oz opened my eyes to a whole world of cuisines.
These are awesome.
I want to rediscover the best of Aussie produce.
Whoa! Here we are, abalone.
And create some amazing dishes with it.
Smells pretty good from down there, let me tell you.
I'll be catching up with my family and old mates.
Hey, I've got something I found.
Oh my dear me, and I've got eyeliner on.
And the people who've inspired my love of food.
I didn't realise how nervous I was going to be cooking with you again.
That's not bad for you.
I'll be returning to old haunts.
That's what I was talking about.
And discovering new ones.
Wow.
You're missing out here, guys. It's gorgeous.
We've come a long way since prawns and the Barbie.
I'm John Torode, and this is my Australia.
I'm in Queensland, Australia's second biggest state. This place has more winter sun than anywhere else in Oz, hence its nickname, the Sunshine State. When I was 22, I spent a very happy 9 months working in a bar on Queensland's Gold Coast. It's great to be back. In the remote, undeveloped tropical far north of Queensland, the temperate climate provides the perfect growing conditions for coffee, tea, and exotic fruit. In fact, there's more tropical fruit produced here than almost anywhere else in the world.
I love the sweetness of mangoes, the sharpness of pineapple, the seeds that flow from a passion fruit. And today, I'm off to Cape Tribulation to meet a man who's a pioneer in tropical fruit growing.
Cape Tribulation is in the heart of the Dane Tree Forest, 200 kilometres north of Cairns. It's one of the oldest rainforests on the planet. And I'm really excited to be here as it's a tropical fruit lover's paradise. I'm heading to the Holy Grail, Cape Tribulation Exotic Fruit Farm. It's run by former biology teacher Digby Gotts and his wife, Alison.
G'day, I'm John.
G'day, John, it's Digby.
I'd love you to show me around.
Yeah, no problem. We've got, there's probably a dozen or so different fruits that are ripe, ready on the tree, so we can just go and pick something and have a nibble.
Beautiful.
Digby and Alison left Melbourne to escape the rat race and moved to Cape Tribulation to start a new life. And it wasn't long before the warm, wet, tropical climate gave them an idea.
We thought we could grow fruit, and maybe live on the fruit, and just drop out and get a self-sufficient life without having to work. But we never grown fruit before. I'm a biologist, a zoologist. And we figured that we'd find out what we could grow commercially by planting everything we could find. And we started taking trips into Southeast Asia and Thailand and Borneo and spend our holiday wandering around the fruit markets and saying, what's that? Don't know, let's have some.
Over the 25 years, how many different types of fruit do you grow here on this farm?
We're getting a bit old now and starting to forget what we've put in, but we think there are around about 150 different sorts of fruit.
One that they're successfully grown is this Brazilian custard apple.
See, I've seen a custard apple before, but I've never seen one with these sort of gnarly fingers coming out of them.
Got to go between the gnarly bits.
But there's a sort of smell, fragrant, sort of almost gingery smell first coming out of there.
So typical custard apple flesh with that smooth, creamy flesh and the black seeds floating loose.
And it does taste like vanilla custard.
The most lucrative food on their farm is this one, originally found in Indonesia.
What is it?
It's called yellow mangosteen. It's fairly thin and it's got this very papery skin.
The whole crop from their 400 mangosteen trees are shipped to one buyer in Sydney.
Now that's sharp. Whoa. Whoa. That's great though.
It's vibrant.
Oh yeah. That's one way to wake up in the morning, isn't it?
Now I'm a big fan of jackfruit. It's the world's largest tree-borne fruit and it's native to Western India. But I've never had the chance to see it on the tree before.
So these will finish up at about 5 to 10 kilos. So you're looking at good football size fruit.
This is something else.
Open him up. Okay. I'm only going to go about a centimetre or so down.
So there's your seed pods. your bits of fruit inside. Wow, look at that.
The flesh is really, really sweet. Honey, banana, bubblegum. Inside there's a large seed, which is also edible after cooking.
Ah.
Boil the seeds for 10 minutes and they're just like tiny potatoes.
Love it. It's like, it's like a sort of sweet melon, passion fruit, all mixed together.
Mm-hmm.
It's absolutely gorgeous.
Really strong flavour.
I'm going to cook a fruity dish later, and that jackfruit has definitely made my basket. There's a whole array of exotics from all over the world here, and now we're off to check out an ancient native Australian fruit.
So, John, this is Davidson plum. It's called plum because it looks vaguely like a plum, but in fact, it's not related to anything else on this planet. It's a species left over in the rainforest from 50 million years ago when the whole of the east coast of Australia was rainforest.
And then this is them here.
And that's them there.
Here I go. Whoa, it's tannic, like unripe grapes, and sticks to the top of your tongue. It's sour, it's sharp, but funny enough, it's quite addictive.
Digby's knowledge, enthusiasm and passion for the world of tropical fruits is infectious.
Digby, thank you very much for showing me around. You're an incredible farmer. Mm. I've had a brilliant time. I've tasted things I've never tasted before. I've seen stuff I've never seen before.
I can't wait to use some fruit from the farm in my next recipe. A tropical granola that's a great way to start your day.
Fruit for breakfast is a joy. And when you're in the tropics, what better to have than tropical fruit? And I'm gonna make a layered granola and fruit compote breakfast dish. This is beautiful. Now, granola is a sort of breakfast food, and it's actually very, very easy to make at home. You can do it in an oven, but I'm gonna do it on the stove in a pot. So, a good knob of butter. I'm gonna add golden syrup and honey to the butter. Bring to the boil and it can become almost a toffee. So add to my bubbling mixture some oats. The oats just start to brown and get hot, and then we're going to put in a little bit of sugar and then toast it. To that toasty oat mixture, literally everything else is gonna go in. So chop up some macadamia nuts and some dried apricots. Macadamia nuts are an incredible thing, grow native in Australia, are really very expensive, but funny enough, it was the Americans who made them trendy. The Australians didn't really eat them. And it's like many of the native foods of Australia, people just don't seem to eat them. And I'm gonna drop these into the pot. Of course, you can use anything you like in this. It's up to you, whatever you want. And then for the rest of the bits and pieces as well. Now some raisins, goji berries, and these are lovely things. They're very, very good for you. Walnuts, pistachios, almonds, and dried banana. Take it off the heat and give it a really good stir. And all that golden syrup and sugar and butter has been soaked up by your oats and just making that fruit glisten and become something really beautiful. And you can't make a cold breakfast with hot granola, so I'm just gonna pour it out and let it cool down. That is how simple granola really is. Now I'm gonna make a little compote from some pineapple and some passion fruit.
First, prepare the pineapple by chopping off the top and the bottom and removing the skin.
Chop the pineapple into nice chunks. Take the core out because the core doesn't cook very well. I love the core of pineapple. It's very hard, but my old man's orange juice factory, there was pineapple cores left around. I'd chew on them. Just, I don't know why, but I think they're really lovely. I think they're full of flavor. To that, I'm gonna add one of my favorite fruits in the whole world, and that's a passion fruit. And I can smell them when I open them up. And that smell is at like my Nana's back garden, because everywhere in her garden there was fruit. There was passion fruit vines all around the fences. There was just amazing amount of fruit.
Then scrape the passion fruit into the pan with the pineapple.
And then a little bit of sugar. Not very much. And that goes onto the heat, and it's gonna cook for about 8 to 10 minutes. Jackfruit. Let's talk about this majestic fruit, because this is an absolute ripper. You can buy jackfruit all around the world from Asian supermarkets when it's in season. It has to be ripe, and it feels like a baby's bottom. It's just soft, but got a little bit of a bounce to it. Now, you can cut into it, or you can just simply break it open. Inside, look at these, look. These here, these wonderful little custardy pods, these pods here, is where the flesh is.
You just need to remove the flesh and take out the seeds. Time to check on the compote.
So my pineapple and passion fruit is ready. It's just softened. Just cool it down a little bit. And now some yogurt. The smallest dribble of honey. And now to add some lime. A bit of lime rind. Mix it together. So to build the dish.
First a layer of pineapple and passion fruit, followed by the yogurt with honey and lime, and then the jackfruit.
So now you see what's happened as its granola's cooled down. It's become this wonderful, soft, crunchy mess, all just sticking together. Spread that across the top. Oh, yum.
Finish with a piece of jackfruit and finally a dollop of yogurt.
And there you have it, my tropical fruit and granola breakfast. So for this recipe and all the rest of the recipes throughout the series, go to goodfoodchannel.co.uk.
Next, I cook up a wild feast.
What could be more North Queensland than croc and chips?
And stop off for a beer and a steak outback style.
And it's very, very, very good. It really is.
Be inspired by a personal journey. John Torode's Australia, brought to you by Emirates. Share your passions with like-minded people. John Torode's Australia, brought to you by Emirates.
After 20 years living and working in the UK, I've flown back home to Australia, to where it all began for me. I'm in Queensland, Australia's second largest state, and here in the far tropical north, you can find the original Aussie wild ingredient, crocodile. It's farmed here sustainably and features on many menus as a native delicacy, but one restaurant in the Daintree has come up with a really innovative way of serving it.
I've come here to Silky Oaks Lodge in the rainforest in northern Queensland because the signature dish here is a crocodile and tarragon cheesecake. That's right, a crocodile and tarragon cheesecake.
The restaurant specialises in serving local ingredients, and chef Rhys Mann tells us about their philosophy.
The crocodile meat comes from a local farm only about half an hour away. So we try to use everything that we can as local as possible. I mean, all the fish that we use is all caught from the Great Barrier Reef. All our vegetables and dairy products are up from the tablelands in Gelatin. And we try to use those to inspire our dishes and try to make the best food that we can. We're trying to use crocodile because it's quite a hard meat to make a dish out of. And just one day we just thought we'd play around and we took the idea of a cheesecake and turned it into a savoury one.
I never smile at a crocodile, but I might smile at a crocodile cheesecake. Thank you. Not what I expected. And let's have a look inside this beauty. Oh, nice. Now that is clever. Mm. I don't necessarily taste the crocodile because the crocodile is a very, very subtle flavour, but what I do get is a wonderful texture. But the flavours of this cheesecake are sharp with cheese, smokiness coming from bacon, and a little tiny hint of fishiness coming from my crocodile. It's savoury, well seasoned, and actually very delicious. I think this cheesecake goes to show that you can, with a bit of adventure, with a bit of bravery, and some really good quality ingredients, make things very, very special.
In Australia, crocodile meat is classified as game, but I think it's closer to a meaty white fish in both flavour and texture. And one of my favourite ways to cook it, wouldn't look out of place, wrapped in newspaper.
Today, I'm gonna make good old-fashioned croc and chips. First of all, make the chips. Peel the potatoes. I have my own special way of cooking chips. I cook them twice. Now, when you're using a deep fryer, be careful. I use a wok, and I use a wok because there is plenty of space to see, and you know what you're doing, and you can control the temperature very easily. Always just drop your chips in very close and let them boil. Funny enough, in northern Queensland, you buy your crocodile in a butcher's shop because it is classified as meat. And most of the butchers actually marinate it for you. And this one's been marinated in a little bit of pepper and some oil. What I'm going to do with it is to cut it into strips so that it cooks very, very quickly. I believe that if you want to cook crocodile, just find a recipe for squid and adapt that recipe, because squid and crocodile cook almost exactly the same. I have a confession to make. The first time I ate crocodile was not in Australia. It was in London. And we used to just grab hold of it, coat it with flour and deep fry it really, really quickly. But I find putting it in batter far, far better, because the flesh is quite delicate and it can dry out really quickly. By coating it in batter, you have a better, softer meat inside your little crispy bits of batter. So season the actual croc itself with pepper, and then a little bag, a plastic bag, with some flour and some salt. Take your crocodile, put it into the plastic bag, and then shake it, and that flour is going to make the batter stick to the crocodile. If you just take the crocodile and with no flour on it and drop it into batter, the batter will fall off. Now, let's get these chips out first. That's the first cook done. They'll go back in to crisp up in a little bit. Now I'm going to make my batter. Two eggs, a little bit of salt, beer, about half the bottle, flour. Sprinkle the top with flour, so the whole top of the batter mixture is coated with flour. It's the easiest way to do it rather than actually measuring it out. And then whisk it together. Drop the crocodile into the batter. So, you watch people in fish and chip shops do this, and it's all you do is you wave it for a little bit, and then you drop it, and that end then floats to the top and it doesn't stick to the bottom. So wave it in, and then boom, in it goes. And it really quickly starts to turn golden brown.
When the batter is all puffed up and crispy, they're cooked.
My crocodile has been in the oil for about 2 or 3 minutes, and now I've got these lovely fingerlings of croc.
Once done, pile them onto kitchen paper to absorb any excess oil and pop those chips back in for their second cook.
Big chips like this are too solid to cook once. You need to cook them first time to blanch them so the heat penetrates the centre, and then the second time so they go crispy on the outside and the middle is cooked. So my chips are now ready. They've just floated to the top and they're all crunchy.
Take them out and salt them while they're piping hot.
So now I'm going to make a little cheats tartare sauce. No mayonnaise, the base of it is with creme fraiche. Parsley, basil, and some thyme. Chop it all up. Some grated lemon rind. Some capers, chopped. Some gherkins, chopped. And mix that in together with a tub of creme fraiche, a squeeze of lemon juice, and bing, bang, bosh, you're done.
Then it's time to put it on a plate.
And just stack the whole thing up. Be proud of your food. Put it on show, tell people what you've got, really just stack it up high and make it look wonderful. You've done all that work, and there you go. It's just starting to look more like a masterpiece.
A spoonful of cheats tartare sauce, a sprig of curly parsley, and we're ready to go.
And there you go. What could be more Australian, what could be more North Queensland than croc and chips?
Next, I go shopping with a top can chef who champions native Australian food.
A shop like this around the corner, I know why you're living here.
And I get to help out in a cattle station where I whip up a curried goat feast.
This is me in heaven.
Open your eyes to a big adventure. John Torode's Australia, brought to you by Emirates. Exploring new flavours with new friends. John Torode's Australia, brought to you by Emirates.
After 20 years of living and working in the UK, I've flown back home to Australia to reconnect with my culinary roots. I'm in the far north of Queensland. Here, the tropical climate provides just the right conditions to grow many of the exciting foods that feature in modern Aussie cuisine. Cairns is the major city of this region. At this market, there's an incredible selection of native and exotic produce, and many ingredients I didn't use until I became a chef.
It wasn't until I went to London, cooked in London, that I actually tasted kangaroo meat. Now, isn't it weird that as an Australian kid growing up in this amazing country, all we seem to do was revert to chops and mashed potatoes and forget natural foods?
Thankfully, that view is old school, and one chef at the forefront of re-imaging native Australian cuisine is Craig Squire. I'm here to find out how he's taken indigenous Aussie ingredients and turned them into modern Australian food at his restaurant, Ochre.
G'day, Craig.
G'day, John. Welcome to North Queensland.
Nice to meet you. So, Cairns.
It's here.
And Rusty's Market.
Yeah.
What's the deal here?
It's been around for a long time, ever since I can remember Cairns, about 30 years ago. It used to be just gravel underfoot and a lot of hippies and people just bringing their produce from small farms around the area, and it's still pretty much like that.
So this is where you get most of your produce from?
Yeah, we come down every week and buy specialty items. We can't get through our suppliers and, yeah, it's really nice to see what's available, though.
Show me around then, mate.
We're here to pick up some ingredients so Craig can create one of his Asian-style signature dishes flavoured with native ingredients.
Yeah. So we're going to get some prawn meat.
Right.
For our sugarcane prawn sticks, yeah? Have you got any green prawn meat? Excellent.
This market is a real eye-opener for exotic ingredients.
OK, so this is the black sapote, or chocolate pudding fruit. And this is the only way it should be eaten. See how, I mean, it's really just... It really is like chocolate pudding.
But so is this one here...
So this is, yeah, this is how they come off the tree, and then you've got to wait to ripen them up.
The Asian communities in Australia have brought their food cultures with them. The ingredients grow well in tropical Queensland and are readily available at this market.
A shop like this around the corner, I know why you're living here.
Yeah, I mean, look at this. This is great. All these chilies, ginger, the galangal, turmeric. Fresh turmeric, that's fantastic.
I'm interested in finding out how Craig is taking Australian food up a culinary notch.
How do you explain your cuisine? What do you... Because people sort of go, oh, bush tucker. It's not bush tucker.
I call it modern regional Australian, basically.
Right. OK.
I don't use the words bush tucker because people generally associate that with rough,
yeah.
you know, campfire cuisine,
yeah.
Which is not what it is, obviously. We use an influence of native Australian in flavouring our dishes, and then very much a focus on regional produce.
The last thing on Craig's shopping list is sugarcane, which he picks up from the juice cellar.
Thank you, excellent, no worries.
And we couldn't leave without trying one of these drinks made with sugarcane, ginger and lime juice.
Thank you, cheers.
Okay, it's like a mojito without the alcohol.
It is like a mojito without the alcohol. In actual fact, with a bit of alcohol, they'd make the best mojito I've ever had.
Classically trained Craig has worked in top restaurants all over the world. But now he's settled in Cairns and dedicated his skills to turning native Aussie food into hoik cuisine. Like this is antipasti. It's sea trout gravlax with green ants, crocodile wontons, emu carpaccio and seared tide roux. And I can't wait to taste some of the native ingredients he uses in his dishes.
So on this tray of foods, many of which I have not seen before, What have we got?
We've got ribaries, which is a form of lily pilly.
So explain to me what a lily pilly, a tree?
It's a fruit. Great clove flavour.
Yeah.
This is your southern kwangdong, very widespread in the wheat belt of Australia.
It's like a plum.
Plum.
Yeah, it's like plum. And orange.
It's very plummy.
It tastes like Christmas.
Then we've got lemon myrtle.
Wow! It's like citronella, isn't it? That's what it smells like, lemon essence.
But we use it as a flavouring. It's really good with, like, you're replacing kaffir lime.
Right.
Like, so in a laksa or, a tom yum soup or flavouring sweet chilli sauce, which is what we're going to have with our prawn sticks today. So the next one is wattle seed. It's one of the most common used bush foods.
Well, I reckon, for me, that's like poppy seeds. And I reckon that sprinkled on top of bread and then roasted, like baked bread,
yeah.
Be amazing.
And the next one is pepper leaf. Grows in the highlands of Tasmania. Sort of a wasabi-ish, horseradish-ish sort of
Yeah, got it. But it's sort of like a spicy tea. You talked about 3,500 different native ingredients in Australia. Out of those 3,500, how many do you use here?
About 20 to 30. And they're the ones that are basically commercially available.
Now, you're going to cook some food for me, aren't you?
Yep.
What are you going to cook?
Well, we're going to cook sugarcane prawn sticks, which is traditionally a Vietnamese dish.
Right.
And so we're using ingredients we just got from the market, with a green papaya salad with a sweet chilli lemon myrtle dipping sauce.
So sweet chilli and lemon myrtle, so this integration of these native Australian products. Craig gets to work on his recipe. The prawns from the market are flavoured with fresh coriander and sesame oil and minced really finely. The sugar cane will add sweetness to the prawn mixture as it cooks. He's making a finely shredded green papaya salad with tomato and chilli to serve alongside. And the chilli dipping sauce features the native lemon myrtle. The presentation is certainly top notch. Wow.
So sugar cane prawn sticks, green papaya salad and sweet chilli lemon myrtle.
It smells delicious. It smells absolutely delicious. And whilst I get to tuck in, Craig's got to get back to the kitchen to prepare for a busy service. So you've got sort of Vietnamese, Thai and Australian sauce all together. Amazing. The prawns taste of prawns, and when I say it, it might sound very strange, but a prawn to me is salty and sweet and quite rich, and that's the flavour I've got from this wonderful minced prawn meat, and it's flavoured with spring onions and coriander, and that is lovely going with that sour but sharp and sweet papaya salad with peanuts and tomatoes running through it. What is cool about this dish is, though, this lemon myrtle, which is a big, strong flavour, is being incorporated in this dish just seamlessly. This is clever cooking. Clever cooking by incorporating an ingredient as strong as lemon myrtle into a dish such as this.
I've never tasted native Aussie ingredients cooked like that before. Now, I want to show you my take on modern Australian cuisine featuring a fantastic native ingredient.
I'm going to be cooking peppered kangaroo, a spiced sweet potato, and a pineapple and chilli relish. Now, kangaroo is now being exported from Australia all around the world. However, if you can't get it, you can use venison instead. They're quite similar in texture, quite similar in flavour. First, I'm going to get ready my sweet potatoes. I'm going to slice them into big hunks, a tiny bit of oil on them, a little bit of salt, and then onto a hot grill.
I want the sweet potatoes to go all charred and smoky. So whilst they cook, I can get going with the main ingredient.
Kangaroo is a wonderful thing. The meat itself is almost fat-free. So the only way you can really cook it is to scorch it. To scorch it very, very quickly. Because if you try and cook a piece of meat like that for a long period of time, it will just simply dry out. And we've got a mix here of actual green, white, black, and pink peppercorns all mixed together. Some salt, and then thyme. Grind that together. Kangaroo is actually a really rich meat. Same as grouse or same as venison. So that richness just needs to be taken away with a little bit of spice.
Coat the kangaroo loin in the crushed peppercorns, making sure it's all rubbed in so the flavour really penetrates.
Now for a little pineapple chutney or a little relish. Cut the pineapple into little squares and we're going to put to that some little bit of chilli. And chilli, sweet chilli sauce and pineapples always work well together. Take the seed out. Remember, we've got lots of spice with our pepper anyway, so we don't need too much. And look at those colours. Just the colours alone are absolutely wonderful. So now we just put a little bit of Japanese vinegar. The vinegar is just enough to bring out the sweetness of the pineapple. Think about sweet and sour pork. There's my little pineapple relish. So take the sweet potato as it's almost cooked, a bit of foil, and make the foil into a little pouch. Take the sweet potato, put the pouch onto the stove, and then add to it a little knob of butter. Leave that on the heat for a minute or so, just so the butter melts and the whole parcel starts to steam. So to flavour the sweet potato, cumin, cardamom, and coriander go into a pan, and roasting of spices brings out their flavour.
Keep the spice mixture moving so it doesn't burn. And when you can smell the aroma, transfer the whole lot to a mortar and pestle, ready to grind.
pound them together. Inside here, you'll see I've got the husk from the cardamom. You don't want it. You don't want it at all. It's time for me to cook that kangaroo. Oil on the kangaroo, not in the pan, because the oil will burn in the pan, whereas on the kangaroo, it will just seal it. And then pick up the paper and roll it in. That's gonna take about 2 minutes on each side. I'm gonna turn it a couple of times just so the roundness of it all gets cooked, but not long at all. This is exactly the same thing as cooking a rare or a blue steak. Just to finish this roux off, a little knob of butter. While the kangaroo rests, prepare some coriander and fresh mint to flavour the sweet potatoes. Mint, yogurt, cardamom, cumin and coriander, all Middle Eastern flavours with my Australian kangaroo. And then my roasted, dried, pounded spice mixed together. Take my little parcel off here of sweet potato. And in here, look, there you go. Just remove the skin and roughly chop the sweet potato. If I was in a restaurant, I'd probably be pureeing this. But as I'm under a tree in Cairns, I can just chop it up and make a lovely little sort of sweet potato salad.
Time to carve the peppered kangaroo loin.
In here, we're gonna slice this kangaroo and it's gonna be lovely and rare. Look, look in there. And you see in there it is, all juicy and beautiful. Sweet potato, and then my kangaroo. My pineapple and chili chutney. The outside. And now a little bit of yogurt there. So there you go, peppered kangaroo, spiced sweet potato and pineapple and chili relish. Some people might call that bush tucker. I call that elegant modern Australian food.
I'm leaving the coastal city of Cairns behind to travel 150 kilometres south to the edge of the outback. I'm in Innit, Hot Springs, and after a long day in the scorching heat, there's no better way to cool down than with a cold beer. This is cattle country, and I've heard this bar has something special on the menu.
You can tell them the beer is just the best here.
What I love about Australian pubs, apart from the beer, is they serve good, simple Aussie tucker, and there's always a steak on the menu, which makes me a happy man. Gary and Ros Burton Shaw do a very particular type of steak, and it's to die for.
I'm Ros.
G'day, Ros. John.
How are you, John?
Nice to meet you. Nice cold beer.
Oh, I'm
and
relieved.
I was just wondering what to eat. Well, but I'll tell you what something takes my fancy.
What's that?
A crumb steak.
Crumb steak, oh, that's beautiful.
We buy the rumps and we slice them and they roll them in flour and egg and then we breadcrumb them and then we fry them in butter and they're really beautiful.
You know, it seems to be, when I was a kid, everything was in breadcrumbs, always crumbs. But crumb steak, I've not seen.
Haven't you?
No. So the crumb steak around here is like the locals' favourite.
I'd say so, definitely.
All those locals can't be wrong. So I can't wait to try this Outback favourite.
A little bit of sauce, or as I like to call it, gravy. This is a signature dish. This is one of those local delicacies. You ask the locals what you should eat in the pub, and this is exactly what everybody's ordering tonight. And the place is packed. And it's very, very, very good. It really is. Mashed potato. Lovely and creamy. The steak, all soft, crispy on the outside. Really well seasoned. It's a joy. I've traveled to the far reaches of the world. I've eaten in some of the greatest Michelin star restaurants ever. But sometimes dropping into a pub, and especially an Aussie pub, and eating something like this is just as good. This is good food, and really good food is about filling your stomach and putting a smile on your face. And that's what this does.
Next, I saddle up and go cattle mustering in the Aussie outback.
That was one of the most amazing experiences of my whole life.
Be inspired by a personal journey. John Torode's Australia, brought to you by Emirates. Share your passions with like-minded people. John Torode's Australia, brought to you by Emirates.
After 20 years living and working in the UK, I've flown back home to Australia, to where it all began for me. I'm in Queensland, Australia's second biggest state, and on the last leg of my journey, I'm hitting cattle country. Australia's cattle stations are the biggest in the world, and most are located in the central or northern outback, which is Australia's most remote and arid landscape.
It's no secret that I love my beef. I know every single cut, and I know how to cook it. But I have never been to a proper Aussie working cattle station, and I've always wanted to see what they're all about, and so today is my lucky day.
I've come to spend the day at Woodley Cattle Station in Ravenshoe, about 150 kilometres due south of Cairns, right on the edge of the outback. It's run by Kate and Peter Wannell.
Suppose this is sort of like a proper Australia, isn't it? Kate, tell me, how long has this station been in the family?
About four generations, John. We've been here 100 years, and my family had slaughter yards and butcher shops, so they actually bought Woodley to whole cattle.
What do you actually do here at Woodley Cattle Station?
The basic operation is breeding beef cattle.
I know there's going to be some fun to be had today and probably a bit of hard work. Can we get stuck in?
Absolutely.
Beautiful. No, you show me the way.
Come through, John, and we'll show you.
Brilliant.
This is cowboy country. So the first thing I need to do is to saddle up. But I have to say, I'm a bit nervous about getting back on a horse.
I'm all right with riding a bike, but that's got two wheels and brakes. This has got four legs and a mind of its own.
Yes, but it's all in the balance. Just stay on top of it. Keep in the middle.
It has been a long time since I've ridden a horse, so Kate's going to show me the reins, and my lovely steed is this beauty, long, tall Sally.
My heart's going about 4,000 miles an hour, Kate.
No, you're doing very well.
Okay.
First time's the worst.
And before I could say, how do I get down again, please, we were off. I was cattle mustering like a proper Aussie cowboy, or at the very least, trying not to get in the way. A cattle muster, or roundup, is the process of moving livestock. So the idea is to move the cattle from pasture to pen. These guys are making it look easy, but trust me, it's a lot harder than it looks. This is a straightforward cattle roundup. Mustering is done for a lot of reasons, including routine livestock health checks, branding, and droving cattle to another location.
That was one of the most amazing experiences of my whole life. I just had about 200 cattle in front of me. Of course, there's other people doing what they're doing. I was just following along, but we just, but look, from there, it was full to this, to they're all there. That's amazing.
Cattle mustering certainly builds up an appetite. As a thank you to Peter and Kate for letting me loose on this station, I've offered to make lunch. It's not the right time of year for the cattle, but they do keep goats as an alternative.
So, Peter, you actually slaughter and butcher goats here on the farm?
Yes, John, probably only a couple of times a year. We do kill our own beef. But this time of year, most of it's a bit lean to be eating.
How do you normally eat your goat?
Roasted, grilled, stewed, curried, whatever comes.
And there's another animal on the farm Peter wants to tell me all about.
They're the Johnson River crocodile, the freshwater one.
Right.
And he lives mainly on fish, shrimps. We'll catch the odd bird. Wouldn't worry a goat or a human or a cow. These crocs won't bite you.
Well, I know they're not going to bite me, mate, because I'm not going anywhere near them.
They don't chase big game. They eat mainly fish.
I was keen to get away from that river and back to my cooking comfort zone.
Thank you.
This bit's a dangerous end, mate.
First, we need to chop some wood for the fire.
I have done it before. Used to do it every single morning with my nana. Because she had a stove, and the only way we had hot water was to light the fire every morning. So, you know, I know how to build a fire, that's for sure.
Whilst my fire gets going, Peter takes me to get my goat, and it was just slaughtered yesterday.
Ah, nice. Nice.
Biggest rabbit you've ever saw.
It's a good-sized goat, isn't it?
It is.
This is me in heaven.
Back over at the campfire, I can start putting together a goat feast for my hosts.
I'm going to cook a goat curry, a really lovely rich tomato and coconut goat curry, and I'm going to also make a damper, the classic Australian bread.
First, to get all the flavours together, grate some ginger and some garlic and de-seed a chilli.
Onions into the pot. A good glug of oil. This is the suet from the goat into my pot as well.
Next, I add my spices.
Garam masala comes in very different forms. This one's got some turmeric, some cinnamon, some cumin and some coriander in it. A good sprinkle.
Some curry powder and then loads of fenugreek for a sweet aniseed flavour. Then it's time to pop it on the fire.
So, the ribs first. I know it's not that elegant, but it's hot in there. And then my belly. Stir it all together.
Finally, I add a little salt, then some tomatoes for a bit of sweetness, coconut milk, water, some curry leaves, pop the lid on and cook away for 2 hours.
So whilst my goat curry is cooking, I'm going to also make some damper. And damper is Australian bread which was cooked in a bush oven or cooked over a fire, and it really is simply a basic scone mix. 2 pounds of flour, and then 100 grams of butter, a little bit of sugar, not very much, and a good amount of salt. One thing about damper is that damper can be eaten both sweet and savoury, whether you decide to have it with a slab of butter, or when we were offered our sort of residentials or our camps for school, they would take a damper dough, they'd wrap it around a stick like that, they'd put it into the fire, and then it was covered in ash and it was absolutely revolting, and then you had to fill it with golden sugar and golden syrup and then eat it.
Then the water goes in and bring all the ingredients together.
Now, bit of butter on your fingers and into your camp oven, a good rub around, and then mould it together. It's lovely and soft. It's a lovely soft dough. And then into your pot and simply flatten it down. So there's our bush damper. That's going to go onto the side of the oven and cook for about 35 to 40 minutes. Lid on, over to my fire, and then put that onto there.
While the food cooks, I go to find Peter, and he's got another job for me, milking Betsy the cow.
Pinch that off there at the top, like, and just close your fist around it.
Yeah, but you got big, strong hands.
You might have big, strong hands by the time you finish too.
Okay, I'll give it a go. Hello, Betsy. Okay. I'll wash. I think I need to find my rhythm here, but oh look, that's amazing. Let's see if I can do two at once. Look at that! How much milk will I get out of this cow?
Well, 5 litres.
5 litres, that bucket would be full.
I better hand it over to the expert or we'll be here all day. A cowboy I could be, a milkmaid, I don't think so.
Thank you very much, my friend. Now he's going to do the proper job, isn't he? Look at the difference, look at the speed.
I leave Peter to finish off the milking as I need to go and check on our lunch, my goat curry.
Look at that. There you go. All that wonderful sauce has now melted into the meat. All that meat has come together. Look at this, look at this. This is, and the meat's falling off the bone. Oh, that is going to be stunning.
Peter's already poured himself a cold beer. Now what my host needs is my goat curry.
Guys, this is my thank you for a brilliant day. There's the curry, right? See, in there.
My favourite meal.
Not bad at all.
There you go, smell that. There you go, take a wadge of that each. Yeah, just pull yourself a bit off.
Yeah. You've done well, mate.
I've done well? Yeah. Well, here you go, here's my curry goat chop. Oh.
That is beautiful.
Mm.
Well done, John. Delicious.
Cooked to perfection, actually. Beautiful.
My favourite part of the day was actually gotten the horse without falling off.
It's not every day you get to play at being a cowboy. It's been amazing to meet Peter and Kate and find out how they run this extraordinary Aussie cattle station.
For this recipe and all the recipes throughout the series, go to goodfoodchannel.co.uk.
Next time, I'm in South Australia the fourth largest state. I'll be fishing for my ingredients straight off the beach.
It's the first fish I've caught in a very long time.
Catching up with an Aussie food legend.
And today I get a chance to cook with Maggie Beer.
And revisiting a childhood fast food favourite.
How am I going to get that into my mouth, I don't know.
I don't think you'll have any problems with that.
Open your eyes to a big adventure. John Torode's Australia, brought to you by Emirates.